Yes, well, first of all, thanks very much to the organizer for giving me this opportunity to give this talk here. I work at the University of Naples Federico II in the group of Mario Nicodemi. And here I will talk about some of our work about the organization of the nucleus of cells. Now, you know, this field that is traditionally a field of biology, say, today these topics are attracting an increasing number of physicists. And the reason is that new experimental technologies have been developed in the last 10 years, essentially, that allowed for the first time to obtain quantitative data about the organization of the nucleus of cells that allow so to apply the methods of physics for the first time. So let's see what is our knowledge today about the organization of the genome in the cell nucleus. You know that the DNA is segmented into long filaments called chromosomes. And the chromosomes are contained in the cell, in particular, they are contained in a membrane called the cell nucleus. But how the chromosomes are folded, are organized within the cell nucleus, has been for long unknown. And say the long-standing idea was that they probably were just randomly folded and randomly mixed together. Instead, as you can see from this image, this is an image from light microscopy, a technology called FISH. Here it's light microscopy, but with a technological improvement that allow to stain with a different color each different chromosome. So you see each color is a chromosome, and you see immediately that they do not mix randomly together, but there is a pattern. They tend to occupy specific regions in the cell nucleus, not in a random way. These regions have been called chromosome territories. And this was very surprising at the time, and it's also interesting for us because the question, of course, arises of what are the physical mechanisms that allow the formation of these kind of patterns.
Excuse me, if there are two regions which are yellow, they
Yeah.
correspond to the same chromosome or there are two chromosomes
Yeah.
colored
Yeah.
in the same way?
Yeah, each chromosome is a different color. Maybe there are similar color, but say the idea is that there is a different color for each chromosome. Some are more spread, some are more
There are two
localized.
disconnected regions which are yellow. Do they correspond to the same chromosome?
Different, two different chromosomes.
Ah, okay, thank you.
Yes, please. Okay. Well, but about the organization of the cell nucleus, there is much more than this because only 10 years ago, essentially in 2009, was invented a new technology called the HI-C. This is not a microscopy technology, but just say that it's a technology based on the sequencing of the DNA. And on some of these technologies have been developed also here within our group in Naples, in particular the GAM technology. Now, this technology, HI-C or GAM, allow to obtain the so-called contact matrices of chromosomes. I show you here an example. This is a region, a small region on chromosome 11. You see it's 3 million of bases along the chromosome 11. And the content of this matrix is the following. Given two sites, I and J, along the chromosome, this matrix gives you the probability of contact between the sites I and J. So how frequently they are interacting with each other. So if you see dark color, it means that they are highly interacting with each other. Light color, it means that they are not interacting much. The pattern that emerge, and you can appreciate from this image, is that there is a non-trivial and complex organization also at the level of chromosome. And there are in particular, you see these squares that I highlighted here. It seems that the chromosome within its territory form some subdomains.
Sorry, what about histones?
Yeah, histones are of course there. I was simplifying. Histones are of course wrapped around the DNA forming this chain called chromatin, but I was trying not to be too technical, but sure.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is a chromatin actually, but I will say chromosome to simplify. So these domains have been called topological associative domains, topological domains, or simply TADs, discovered in 2012. So there is a pattern of organization also at this level, but there is organization even at finer levels, at the scale of the gene, of the single genes. You know that along the DNA, there are genes that encode genetic information. However, genes occupy only like 2% of the whole genome. Other regions have been discovered, in particular the so-called regulatory elements that are not gene, but can regulate the genes. For example, there are some regions along the genome that can activate a gene when they come into close spatial proximity with the gene itself. So this is just an example. So also to let you appreciate that the three-dimensional structure of DNA beyond its linear sequence has functional roles. So it's important for the cell function. And in fact, if the chromosome is folding for some reason in a wrong way, a misfolding of the chromosome can easily lead to disease. This has been recently discovered that misfolding linked to diseases in humans like congenital diseases and even severe cancers. So to summarize, we've seen that the genome is a complex organization at these different scales, going from the single gene to the whole nucleus. So say there are four or five order of magnitudes of organization, and all of this organization is functional. And so, of course, this is the data, the kind of data we are working on. And the question that we are trying to answer is, what are the mechanisms behind? What are the mechanisms, how this pattern can emerge? How this pattern are established and how the cell can control this? So this is the model, a very, very simplified model that was proposed. It is one of the first models proposed to explain the chromosome organization, the strings and binders polymer model of chromatin. Developed in our group, the idea was very simple: to understand what are the patterns that chromatin folds, we have to understand what are the interactions. So we imagine that contact patterns emerge by the interactions between chromosomes and some mediating particles. So I'm not going to find details of the model, but the ingredient are very simple. A chromosome, or even not just a chromosome, just a part of a chromosome, can be modeled as a string polymer, a string of beads. Technically, it's called a self-avoiding walk. Essentially, the string move randomly, but the beads cannot overlap each other. Then there is a gas of binders, some particles diffusing in the nucleus that can mediate the interactions between the string sites. And these particles are called binders in the model because they can bind to some regions along the string called the binding sites. And in this way, mediate the interaction between distal sites. So essentially, we have a system Hamiltonian made of three parts. We have a free self-avoiding string, a free particle Hamiltonian, and then a term of interaction between the binders and the string. This is just short-range interaction by which you see the thing that I want to highlight, that this interaction can create bridges between distal sites. For example, it could bridge, you can imagine, a gene with its distal regulatory elements. So it's a simplified scenario, but let's see some properties of this simple model. Here I consider, say, the simplest possible SPS model, where each site along the string is a binding site. So the binders can attach to every site along the string. It's a simplification, but it's useful to derive, say, the general properties of this kind of systems. So on the right side, you see here the phase gate diagram of this polymer model. And the two control parameters are the concentration of the particles, how many particles binders you have, and the energy of interaction between the binders and the string. As you can see here, at the folded equilibrium, the system can be only in a few stable thermodynamic phases. if the concentration of binder and the energy are low, the system is in a coil phase. Essentially, it is open randomly for the polymer is not distinguishable from a self-avoiding chain. But if you pass a threshold, technically known as data point, you will go in another phase, a globular closed phase. So this is a well-known transition in polymer physics to call it to globule transition. And it's common actually to all self-interacting polymers. So the thing is good I want to highlight is that this is a simple way in which the cell can regulate its conformation because it's a switch-like mechanism. If a cell needs, for example, for some functional reasons, if needed that a region from the coil has to be closed, it is only necessary to pass a threshold. So without any fine-tuning of the parameters, it's a very stable mechanism for the cell. And the cell can act on both these parameters, can act on concentration and energy. Just for example, you can act on concentration by, for example, activating a gene that produces these red particles. So next step is, with this simple model, explain the patterns? You remember the complex pattern that we have seen, for example, in the contact IC matrix. The answer is yes. For example, can we explain the tags, these domains that are in the chromosome? It's very simple, even trivial with this model. Because if you consider this time that you have two types of binding sites, so you have a red region and a green region along the polymer, and the red sites can interact with red particles, the green with the green particles. Of course, at the folding co-globule equilibrium phase, the polymer will fold this time into two separate globules. And if you look at the average contact matrix, of course, you will have something like this. So you can reproduce the TAD-like pattern in a very, very simple way in this framework. But reality, of course, is more complex than this. And unfortunately, I don't have time to go into the details, but I want to mention that if we consider more complex polymer model, say with more than two types of binding sites and with a more complex arrangement along the polymer chain, we can explain the folding, reproduce the contact patterns in AC of real genomic regions. This shown here is just an example. This is a region of 6 million of bases along the mouse genome around an important developmental gene, SOX9. And this is a structure derived by the SPS. And as you can see from the comparison between the contact matrix predicted from the three-dimensional structures, that is the bottom triangular matrix and the upper triangular matrix that are SVD types, we can reproduce these kind of models, also more fine patterns that we actually see in ACs. We have realistic models of real regions of the DNA. Now I want to show this other example because maybe, I don't know, some of you may have in mind the question of but what are these molecular factors that are the determinants of folding? What are the binding sites that are interacting with each other and these particles that are mediating the interaction? Now, this is a huge open question, of course, but at least in some cases, we think we have understood the sum of these determinants of folding. And the particle predicted to be the mediator of the interaction has also been detected experimentally. So this is this region, HOXB, these are all is still on mouse genome. And you see reds, this red and this green are all HOXB genes. The difference is still very technical. It's just say that green genes are active. Red genes are like in an intermediate state. They are not activated yet. It's called the poised state. So we built a SBS polymer model of this region by assuming that there are homotypic contacts between the red genes mediated by red particles and green genes mediated by red particles. Now, the folding pattern that we derived with this hypothesis was confirmed by microscopy experiment. As you can see on the right, I show you just some snapshots, some examples, but by microscopy, you can measure the distance, the physical distance, for example, between two red genes or two green genes. And so you can derive a full distribution of distances and can build some contact matrix-like data, like this one. This is, say, a mini contact matrix including only a subset of the genes in the OXB region. And as you see from the agreement that the pattern predicted by the SPS model is confirmed. So it's confirmed that the red genes are interacting with the red genes and green with green. But as I said before, also the mediators have been discovered. Very briefly, this was discovered by three triple colocalization microscopy. So with the microscopy, you can measure at the same time the position, for example, or a red gene, another red gene, and the mediators. And to summarize, you see in this pictorial view here, the red mediator, the green mediators and red mediators are two different types of polymerases. The polymerases, maybe you know, it's the machinery that transcribes the gene, but this can be of two types and mediate respectively the interaction between the red and green sites. So at least locally, in this case, we have identified the particles that are the drivers of the folding of this region. Last thing that I want to show is another work that we did in collaboration with an experimental group at Max Planck Institute in Berlin. Here we studied the effects on chromosome folding of genetic mutations. You see here we modeled a region system in human cells. And as before, we can reproduce very, very well the contact pattern seen from experimental IC. On the bottom, you see the contact matrix constructed by the NSBS model. And on the bottom, one of the derived 3D structures. Now, we studied this region because in this region, different mutations, I show you here one example, an example of a duplication. If this region of the genome is duplicated, it is present in two copies in the cell. In this case, this gives rise to a disease called syndactyly. It's a malformation of the hands. So what we did is try to implement this mutation in the polymer model that we have for the healthy cell. And so try to predict what are the consequences on the contact matrix. So notice that in this case, we don't have any fitting parameter that we can adjust. Just predicted what happened with the application, and here is the result. You see here on the top the SBS prediction. We predicted, as indicated by this arrow, that there is a so-called ectopic contact, a contact that was not present in the healthy case, but is present here. And this contact was also functional because it's a contact between a gene, V26, and a regulator, this red spot here. So as I said in one of the previous slides, this makes the gene to be ectopically activated in the case of disease, in the case of the application. A gene that should be instead of in a healthy cell. Now, to conclude, this prediction was confirmed by independent IC experiments that were conducted by our collaborator on cells that carry the mutation. So taken for patients having the hand malformation. And they confirmed this ectopic pattern of interaction. So this is just to let you appreciate that also the medical implications of the structure of DNA can be strong. So conclusion, we have seen essentially that with new technologies have revealed that the genome has a complex and functional three-dimensional structure. And so the availability of these rich new experimental data allow us to study for the first time in a quantitative way the spatial organization of the genome. In particular, so theoretical physics can play an important role in this field because it can provide principal models to explain the mechanisms behind the data. And as we have seen, it's also possible to make quantitative prediction that in turn can be tested up by a new experiment. And so in particular, we have identified some of the mechanisms that drive chromosome organization with a very simple and basic model. And for example, we have found some of the local drivers of folding that have been experimentally also detected. And in the end, we have seen how also predictions on pathogenic genomic mutation can be predicted by the model and have been validated independently by the experiment. Just want to acknowledge all the group, all the group of Mario Nicodemi, all the group in Naples, and our collaborators that are the experimental groups that worked with us on these topics. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think we should clap. Maybe only me, but are there questions?
Yes.
You said something that the different polymerases are the keys of the folding, but this is what I find puzzling is that the binding of polymerases to DNA is not very stable. It should be temporary.
No. It is because it's more complex than I said. Of course, the polymerases are not just there alone in the cell nucleus. They form some condensates, a lot of polymerases together, condensate, and are localized in some precise region in the nucleus. They are called transcription factories. So you have to imagine this condensate where the genes can co-localize, not just a fluctuating polymerase that go there and then go away.
Usually the polymerases are there to transcript genes. Therefore, they are attaching with all of the cofactors and then transcribing genes, okay? But they are not stable in one point. They should move along, slide along the DNA in order to transcribe. This is what... So you see, there are not a fixed point. This is which I found.
Yeah, exactly. It's more complex, but exactly there is this huge complex where the genes co-localize that contains polymerases.
Okay.
Can I make a question?
Sure.
When you have this binder, one naively would say that you are swapping from a self-avoiding walk to the usual random walk. Is it really true?
No, there is a state that is like a random walk, but this is the transition line, the theta point, the so-called theta point, where the entropic forces balance with the attracting forces and the polymer behaves exactly as a random walk. So there is, and it's possible also, there are proofs that in the CERB there are also regions folded in this state, in the theta point, not only in the open and closed conformation.
Another question, just to make the life more complicated. This long string can also make nodes, can have non-trivial topology.
This is also an open question. Only recently, imaging technologies are improving, so we can effectively look at the answer is probably not, because it would be difficult for the cell to regulate if there are knots. But this is an open question. It's also possible because there are in the nucleus some machinery that can cut DNA, so knots could be also released in case. Mm-hmm. So these are all the topoisomerases.
Okay, thank you.